these four steps must be significantly important, and these four steps are to be shown very clearly. So the first thing is basically assumptions. Whatever the assumptions you are making, and if the problem statement, from the problem statement you can understand, you have to write them, because sometimes we ignore this part, we omit this writing assumptions part, but that makes a lot of influence, or that makes a lot of difference in formulating the problem and getting different results. So that is very important, to write the assumptions. So that is step number one. And step two is basically the setting up of the balance equations. It could be the overall mass balance, it could be component balance, or any of the algebraic relations, such as this absorption column problem. You have seen that there is a equilibrium relations like this. So this type of relations and balance equations are basically the part of step two, which is the problem formulation. So that is the step two. This you have to show very detailed and clear manner. Then third step is the solution part. Once you write this balance equations and set up the problem formulations, then you will be able to see whether the set of equations are algebraic, linear algebraic, or a non-linear algebraic kind of thing. Maybe I can make this shorthand form. So maybe it is a linear algebraic or non-linear algebraic or ODE or PDE, depending on the problem. So this kind of set up of equations, you will see that whether you will employ the particular algorithm, particular solution strategy, solution technique. So that is the step three. And step four is the results that you have obtained, whether they are desired results or making any significance. For example, in the last lecture, we have seen, let me start the recording. Recording started, thanks. In the last example, we have seen that the significance of the inverse matrix. So this kind of thing are very important. It also helps you to understand the whole problem, the physics involved in the problem, the mechanism that is there in the process. So this significance and making and writing, it helps you to grasp the concept. It is also another important step. So these four steps are basically the code of your modeling task, any of the modeling and simulation part. But maybe this step three, you will see that the requirement of computer is required, or you know, particularly MATLAB for solving the equations or solving the simultaneous equation. But other three, the step one, step two, and step four, these invariably requires the hand calculations, or not calculations, rather writing in your writing in shorthand. So typically this MATLAB offers many advantages, all of you that know. So mostly we'll try to solve this equations and different problem through MATLAB. A later part of the course will see some examples, maybe the similar examples, which can be also solved from Aspen simulations. So continuing to that, there are three assumptions that in my mind, that or maybe in my opinion, that these are the significant assumptions that one should clearly write, which is the flow rate of the liquid and gas at each plate are equal. That we always do in order to avoid lot of other complexity. So we assume that molar flow rates are equal, they don't change. Then the Nikhil, any problem? Then the this equations that we are actually writing the equilibrium relations that is existing on each of the plate. We are also trying to utilize the same relations at the end of the tower, that means at the exit point and at the entry point, by making these assumptions that the exit concentration, that is the solute concentration in the liquid, that is very less. So we can still hold the linear relations that is there. So this assumptions is also important, so that at this boundary and the inlet and exit boundary, you can also make the algebraic relations to be hold true. So then and finally the trays are ideal, that we all also write. So this is how you actually write the first step, and then you go for this balance equations, which is the macroscopic mass balance, we can call the overall mass balance. So rate of mass int, or other mole balance, if you, that is a more significant term, the mole balance. So this this is how we actually write the different relations, and we employ this equilibrium relations by substituting this yn plus 1, because it is any of the nth tray we are actually making the balance. So liquid flow rate coming from the top, leaving the nth tray, and vapor flow rate going from the bottom tray, which is n plus 1, and leaving that nth tray. So this gives us this particular relations. And then if we change the n from the at this point and all other plate and at the final point, we'll get a different equations. So these are the set of equations that we actually will get. I have not written all, but few of them are actually written because these are all similar. So if you write in this way all the balance, all the plates, the relations that you are actually getting, then you can actually visualize the problem in a very detailed manner. The clarity would be there. So you will be able to see that this represents a kind of diagonal matrix. We often call a tri-diagonal matrix algorithm, or TDMA. Those that's the algorithm that we actually consider, but it's the architecture of this matrix looks like that there is a one main diagonal and there are two off diagonal coefficients. Others are basically zero. So this is how then you will be able to see that what particular algorithm that you want to make. Now again, one point of caution is that if you write in this way, you can also, as I said, you can also visualize. At the same time, you will be able to see whether the diagonal element are getting any zero or not, because if the diagonal elements are zero, then you have to do the partial pivoting. So that is one and a word of caution. So it is very important to write all the relations or making the balance equation at all stages or all tray, so that you can find out whether any zero is coming at the diagonal element, and whether any redundant equations you are actually getting or not. So as I said in the last class, that there should be as many number of unknowns, as many number of independent equations. So this actually gives you an idea that this can be solved by Gauss elimination. And in MATLAB, this backslash is typically the algorithm that is used for Gauss elimination. There are other techniques. I mean, this you can also do matrix inverse. But as I said, that if the number of unknowns or the number of equilibrium or number of equations are more, then matrix inversions is computationally extensive. So time consuming, and sometimes the numerical accuracy is not there, unlike the other, because the typical advantages that we know in terms of Gauss eliminations, and many of this, rather most of the linear algebraic problem in engineering applications, they employ this Gauss elimination technique majorly. So these are the output, or these are the results that you will get for all the concentration. You can also calculate the y from the relation. You can also extend maybe this x and y, you can plot and see the variations as the number of plates. Maybe this is plate number 1, this is plate number 2, up to This is plate number 6. Just you can see that how the concentration are increasing or decreasing, what kind of. So this is what I was calling that step 4. That the data that you are actually getting, after that, whether you can extend that, whether you can extract some more information. So all the steps that I have mentioned in this particular lecture, from 1 to 4, they're actually important. So this is the significance, if any. Now, have you done the inverse of this matrix, the coefficient matrix? Have you looked at any of the zero is coming or not? I didn't frame that question. It was maybe I did that mistake, but I was actually interested to see that if you have solved the inverse matrix and got any zero in the column. Have you seen any zero in the inverse matrix, any of you? If not, or if yes, then let me know, or you can try at home. I mean, after this class, you can see whether you are getting any zero in the inverse matrix. If you have solved it using MATLAB.
Sir, are these values correct for x1 to x6?
Yes, these are correct values. These are correct values, yes. I was asking that this coefficient matrix, you know, the significance or the discussion that I was making in the last class, whether A inverse, the meaning of the each of the elements in the A inverse matrix. So in the similar way, have you calculated the inverse matrix coefficients? So if this is the A matrix, then what would be the A inverse? And elements of this inverse matrix. So because the last class we understood the interactions which is involved in the inverse, the real matrix or the coefficient matrix, and inverse matrix coefficients are basically the cause for the effect that is we are actually seeing. That means the concentrations at each plate that we are actually, the mole fractions at each plate that we are actually seeing are the results of the flow that is coming from each of the tray to the next tray. So I was interested or rather curious to see whether this inverse matrix, which is a 6x6 matrix, whether the elements are zero or not.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, sir, I got no zeros in the matrix.
Okay. That is expected. I mean, can you tell why?
I guess all letters are affected by one another, I guess.
Yes, absolutely correct. That's the thing. I mean, yeah, thank you. So that is the reason. I mean, this is an example that you see from the absorption column. Maybe you can also think of the similar type of problem for extraction column, or let's say some stripping column, stripping tower. So these examples can be many. I mean, different as per the different applications. So you should always be curious to see the results that you have obtained, and further some more extra informations that you can get or not. So that is the way we should do it. And then the second problem that we actually gave for this, what is called information flow diagram, that was shown in the last class for one of the example problem. Here it is a mixing balance, a mixing vessel. So this vessel typically contains some solvent initially, and then solvent with two different compositions, component, solute component A and B are actually allowed to enter into the vessel. So there is basically a mixing, and mixing is uniform because of the stirring. So we consider an ideal mixing, and then the concentration actually then changes. The components, the A and B, they at the inlet and at the outlet. So one refers to at inlet and to the Ci1 and Ci2 that we were actually seeing. So that is, I think this is, so that is the concentration at the outlet and Ca1 and Cb1 at the inlet. So typically we see that there are three different variables. If we mark them, one is V, one is Ca2, and one is Cb2. These two we are interested to see. So each of these block that connected to each of these differential equations, and basically the solution of those unknown variables. So this reflects that this is input, this is also input, and these are the output. Now F1 and F2 can be controlled using some valve, right? So if that is the case, then some extra relations will appear, as we have seen in the last class. So that adds the complexity to the problem. Next is that we also allowed that we also made a changes in the vessel that suppose A and B, they actually react. They are reacting component, and they actually react by second order stoichiometric the relations, like this. This is the overall rate in mole per unit time, so multiplied by the phi. So this rate term actually causing some extra additional term, right? So the balance equations will be modified. So there are now additionally two terms are actually coming, right? Because since they are reacted, so C and D, they are actually formed in the vessel. So if you remember that there was a inlet stream and then outlet, but outlet will have now all the components A, B, C, D, right? So we have to also write the balance equations for C and D. Now R is almost like a additional, like an inflow to the term, which is C and D, because C and D are generated in the reactions. So in terms of moles per unit time, which is the unit for all the terms consistently across the balance equation. So we can see that this is a inflow term for C and D component, and this is a outflow term for A and B component. So this actually causes two more blocks to appear. So up to this, maybe I use a different color just to indicate the difference. So this block, this and this, we actually had in the last part one, where we didn't have the C and D. But here we see that there is a reaction term happening, which is algebraic relations. And then reaction term is now added to this block, and basically affecting, and also affecting this first two block. So this is how the information flow diagram would look like for the second part. I didn't see all the assignments, but very hardly one or few assignments I was looking, but I didn't notice the C and D term that is involved in the IFD of this part two. But it should be added, that is the thing, because that also is an unknown or unknown variable to the system. So any doubts remain or any confusion?
So please share the solution PDF as well.
Yes, these are all part of the lecture materials. So this will be shared.
Sir, can you explain the second part of second question again, the IFD?
So what I was saying that earlier there was no reaction. So this part one, there is no reaction. Right, so there was only two unknown variable, which is the exit concentration of solute A or component A in the solvent, and exit concentration of component B in the solvent. So this part one IFD is clear. It's straightforward. It comes from the overall mass balance. So rho is basically uniform that we assume. There is no density variations. That's why. Otherwise, this is a mass balance, but we are writing dV dt. So we are getting the variation in volume, which is now added as an input to this block and this block, which are basically trying to solve the concentration of this A and B at the outlet. So two refers at outlet and one refers at inlet. But F2 is a input because it is known, that is known to the system. So that's why this is appearing at this side. So this actually solves the CA2 and CB2. But now in the second part, we are actually saying that this A and B now reacts according to the stoichiometry. So this maybe we write another step that small r equal to this rate constant that is Kf Ca Cb, right? So this is per unit volume. But we just multiply it with the V to make the unit in moles per time so that we get a consistent unit across all the term. So F are basically volumetric flow rate. So if you write up to this, then it invariably tells us that the C and D, which are actually getting generated, which are actually getting formed as a part of reactions in the vessel, so they will also go out. They will also leave the system. So that means we can also see the time variation. We can also see the time variation of those components C and D at the outlet. And since they were not present at the inlet, the C and D were not present, so that term is basically zero. So if you write that F1 C, there is no control set, CC1, because that is zero, because there is no C present at the inlet, similarly for D. So this two additionally creates two unknown variables, that's why two extra blocks. And these algebraic relations are actually required in order to calculate this R term. So that's why these three blocks are extra. And this R is now going to this particular block, this particular block. At the same time, it is also going to this block because A and B are also depleted by the part of reactions. So this term is, should go there. So this is the modified IFD that we can see. There can be different variations, but one thing must be remembered that as many unknown variable through algebraic relations or whatever unknowns that we are actually calculating in the system. So number of blocks, number of information blocks should be clearly visible. You can arrive some different configurations, but number of blocks would not change. Number of blocks would not change because that relates that number of blocks is basically number of unknowns. Now R is getting calculated intermediately, and that is getting used, but still it is unknown. It is not known because it requires the value of V and CA2 and CB2. So basically it also adds one more block to the system. So this is the IFD that we can see as a modifications to the question, the part two. Is that clear?
So?
Yes, sir.
So where should we practice these problems related to the IFD, because we cannot find them in the book, Rogers Frank. So do you have any idea?
Yes, definitely. You have the soft copy of Roger Frank's?
Yes, sir.
Oh, great. Then you can share to all of the batchmate and as well as me, because I couldn't find the soft copy. But I can give you some material. Study material is that W.F. Ramirez, this book. This book is typically has been written on the with the help of this Roger Frank's book. So what I thought that after tomorrow's class, I will share the chapter 1 and chapter 2, which are basically, there are many example problem as well as exercise problem of information flow diagram. But if you have the Roger Frank's book, then it is easy to look at. There is chapter 4 called basic modeling. Right, the chapter 4 is the basic modeling. There you will see that many examples, tank problem, mixing vessel problem with reactions, steam jacketed vessels. There actually many information flow diagram is there. So you can practice. And this Ramirez book, I'll share the chapter after tomorrow's class. There you will see a lot of example problem are there. So you can practice. And exercise problems are also there. You can do practice from there. I'll discuss I will show after this to you from the Ramirez book, showing that there are many examples.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so this part is over. The discussion of this assignment part. Next, we go to this next phase. Maybe I save this document. Okay. So this will be shared to you, so we don't have to worry. Okay, now maybe I just quickly describe this Ramirez part. So this is the a book the whole ebook is there. As per the content will be covered, you will be shared the chapters. So if you have looked at that, I have initially shared that there is the preliminary chapter or very basic introduction chapter. Then this steady state chapter, steady state lump system, and introduction of this different balance equations, mass balance, energy balance. So these two chapters I will share with you. Now here you can see that there are many information flow diagram is there. Maybe I show it from here itself. Just one or two examples. Yes, so this is example 1.7. Yeah, so horizontal convexing nozzle. So different examples are there. You just will see that this is additionally unhelpful. So typically the lecture materials will be covered from this Ramirez as well as the Roger Franks, but mostly they are similar, these two books. You can see that another example is there. This is 1.6, which is I think this piping problem, analysis of piping network. So this particularly, this is the problem statement or the picture that is there in hand, and then you have to suppose find the unknowns. So these steps have been written, and you will see that how the blocks are made. So this will be useful to you. Now in continuation, this particular absorption plate column problem that I actually gave is a part of this book. You can also refer to it. Additionally, this there is one more example. I can show it. So this six plate absorption column that I actually gave as an assignment is taken from this particular book. And then this another example that is there, it involves many more equations. So which is a distillation problem. So you can see that there are two distillation column, which is actually a commercial alcohol manufacturing plant. You will see that many distillation units are actually used. So if you just look at the process diagram, just for understand that, you will see that there can be many more equations. There can be many unknowns, many unknown variables. So relating to each connection. So this is typically a process calculations the diagram, the process industries, which is the alcohol distillation process. And you will see that there are several unknowns at each of this block if you make balance. So this is typically this is the feed which is having 80% water, 10% alcohol, and 10% organic material. So after heating, you will send to first distillation column, you get the vapor, distillate, you get some distillate which is again heated, sent to the second still, which is a second distillation column, and finally you get the purified or the final product, which is having 95% alcohol, 5% water, and 5% water and no, sorry, as a bottom product, you will get this thing and organic part. So this, you just see this example, you will understand that there can be many variables which actually relates to several equations. So just additionally, this example, you keep a note of it, and you will see that this can be also very easy to solve using AX equals to B in this diagram. And the initially that I was saying that you should avoid the partial pivoting, you should avoid the non-zero, you should avoid the zero in the diagonal element. So these are actually described here, and the MATLAB code is also written. So the beauty of this book is that Ramirez's book has been written mostly, the code, the MATLAB file are actually given. So you can basically practice them, because you can expect that there could be MATLAB writing assignments as well as the exam exercise problem or examination problem would be there. So a small functions, small subroutine, but it would be there. So it employed this is backslash. So backslash is basically the Gauss elimination technique. You can read more detail in MATLAB. Just type help and help, then this backslash. You will get the algorithm that is involved. So you will see that there are 13 unknowns, or I think not 13 unknown, I think 19 equations are there. So you will see that is another examples. So this I actually wanted to share. The other chapter or the other section is involving the nonlinear algebraic equations, which I will cover in the tomorrow's class. Today I wanted to show one more final examples from information flow diagram, which actually covers both mass balance as well as energy balance. So this again, this example has been taken from Roger Frank's book. Those who have, you can refer to. This is problem number 4.8, the subsection 4.8, simultaneous mass and energy balance. So it is again.
So no one has it.
Okay. Take it. This I have the notes, so I explain it here. Unfortunately, I don't have the soft copy, this Roger Frank's book, but whatever chapter I'll cover, I'll make this kind of notes so that you can understand. Okay, so this examples is a combination of both mass and energy balance. So you can see that this overall balance equation that we have written for the variation in volume is actually this is a mass balance relations or mole balance, overall mass balance. And this is basically the energy balance. So you see that this the problem statement or problem that is given in hand is some flow is going in and flow going out, but there is a jacket that has been surrounded by the vessel, and it transfers some of the heat after steam. So basically it allows to steam to surround the vessel to keep the temperature at T2. So we are interested to see the time variation of this temperature in the vessel. So this Q terms actually is a heat transfer across the wall. So there is a heat transfer area that is also involved, and temperature difference is TS minus T2. So we can see that this is this block actually refers to an algebraic equations with an intermediate unknown, that is Q. And then this Q we can write in the form of overall heat balance equation. So this is the accumulation term, this is the flow in and flow out. Now this we cannot directly write this T2 by just because it's a difference in temperature. So that is the correct way of writing is T2 minus T reference. So there should be a reference temperature. Similarly, T1 minus T reference. So this this is the just the energy balance part or the Yeah, just the energy balance point and involving one unknown, which is the only the temperature. Now this temperature, this T2 that we are actually making to connect it to this particular relations, because we want to calculate the Q. And one important is that this, since this is a steam jacketed vessel, which is having the temperature TS, the saturation temperature, it is typically controlled through the some pressure regulator, where we regulate the pressure to keep the temperature at particular saturation temperature. And we all know that this TS and FPS, the saturation pressure and saturation temperature, are related to this Antoine equation. So this is an algebraic relation which is typically supplied or typically known to us. So that is the otherwise we can also mention the particular steam temperature, that is steam is available at this particular temperature. So this is a basically input. This whole thing is basically input. If it is relationships made available, then we can see that the TS can be calculated. Otherwise, TS is directly supplied. So this is the simplified diagram of just the relating one in, inflow and one outflow, and the temperature changes due to transfer of heat from the steam jacket to the particular vessel through the across the boundary. Now, this can be made more complicated. This can be made more complicated by saying that similar to the assignment problem, we are adding two components. Instead of one, we are adding two components with two different specific heat, CA and CB. Just since this is a liquid stream, we are writing as C. Just the CP and don't making not making any difference to CP, CB, but it's a C, the specific heat, liquid specific heat. So this other things are remaining the same. Just we made the changes in the way the steam is actually surrounding the vessel, and there is only one outflow. Outflow is one, but inflow is two, because two different components are added. So what the different modifications are, what are the changes that we'll make, we'll see the diagram. But typically for any complex model, this general guideline one has to make one has to understand very clearly or very thoroughly. So I have written these steps in detail. So let us discuss this part. So whenever there is a, maybe I increase the font a little bit. So whenever there is a complex model, for example, this kind of situations where we have two components, both mass balance and energy balance are there. Maybe I add the variable temperature. Then first thing is that we list down the equations defining all the symbols. So that we always do in terms of relating the unknown variables through equations. Now, let us see from here a particular example what we are actually seeing. So this one and two are basically a single concept. I mean, this unknown variables relating to equations by doing this natural cause and effect. So what are the different components, this A and B? So the component mass balance will give the A and B concentration at the outlet. So maybe overall mass balance comes at point number A. So this gives us the variation in volume. Now we have added two more complexity. That is this area that we earlier times, we with this particular example, we kept it constant. We didn't say that any variation of area is happening, but it can vary. It can vary this as a part of volume variations. So as per the liquid height, you know, changes, the liquid volume changes. So area available to the steam jacket or the outlet wall to the vessel content. So this area can vary as a part of volume variations or height variations. So this there should be one more algebraic relations which actually solves this area. Then the jacket heat transfer that gives us the Q. specific heat of the vessel contents. So this whole vessel contents and the outlet flow that is part of mixing. So any property, let's say a specific heat or temperature, the variables. So whatever the they are having in the vessel inlet or vessel content and at the outflow, they will be the same. So this specific heat that can be also calculated. So two refers to the outlet condition or outlet point. So then there is a heat balance equation, which actually gives us the temperature, the unknown temperature. So one thing is that there is a heat transfer relations, which is a algebraic relations relating the heat transfer across the jacket wall. And then there is a heat balance, which is a differential equations. So there is a difference in the nature of the equation. So this is an algebraic equation and this is a differential equations, because we are trying to see the time variations or the kind of, you know, this lumped parameter model where we do see only variation with respect to temperature, sorry, with respect to time. So time is the independent variable, or the time is the with respect to time, we are trying to see the how the unknown variables are actually changing the temperature and the volume or the concentrations, right? So, and then finally, this this particular block that I was actually referring, this saturation pressure and saturation temperature. So this actually gives us the, so these many variables, some of them are known, some of them are unknown, we can have. So writing in this way will help you to get a clear understanding in the way that what are the different blocks we have to make, how many unknowns, how many known value. So this gradually follows to the next step, that what are the boundary input. That means sometimes we have seen that in order to calculate the intermediate unknown, there are some input stream or input line that we are actually allowing. For example, in the assignment problem, you have seen that we have supplied F2. We have supplied the V or R, capital R, to some other blocks. So this boundary input, some of them can be intermediately calculated, some of them are available to us. So that we can also list down as a more segregated manner. And because these are all variables, but some of them are input directly. Maybe we cannot call variables, because these are typical constant, typical values that are supplied. And what are the variables of which the initial values must be known, because these all connect to the ODE. So number of ODEs actually refers to the number of these variables of which that we are trying to calculate the variations with respect to time. So there must be some ODE. If we want to solve the ODE for this relating these variables, there should be initial values. So V, CA, CB, and T2, these are our four unknowns, our four variables that we are actually trying to solve. So at this point, we are trying to see what are the concentration variation, what is the temperature variation, and volume variation, of course, that actually involves. So this is the way I think one should proceed to further, you know, get a better hold of this making information flow diagram and solutions, and then arrange in such a sequences, such a sequence that there should be flow, that a flow should be there, which one to start with and where to end. So we'll see in the next page that how the information diagram flow look like. And finally, once that all the variables are required that we want to solve, they should be supplied by some other equations. So this particular point we actually made explained in the last class. So it says that how many variables that you have actually listed down, you have also made the blocks, and just see that in order to solve that particular differential equations, or in order to solve that particular algebraic relations, the others unknowns or other parameters, other property, other values must be supplied by some other equations. So once that is done, then actually this part, this one to point number one to point number five, that is actually time taking, and that is actually detailed and rigorous part of this process. Because if you are doing like this, then solution is not a problem, or getting results is not a problem. The main difficulty or bottleneck is that the idea, making a clear idea about what you are going to do, listing down all the variables, arranging them in a sequence, such a sequence that there should be flow existing. So that is the procedure, or that is the typical guidelines that must be followed. Now you just see that this particular problem that we actually describing, the information flow diagram is looking like this. It is a bit more exhaustive in nature, but one can understand. So I'll just take a 1 minute or 2 minutes pause to you just go through this information flow diagram, and then then there will be some doubts or queries, or I'll explain it again. So this starts with this, first is the overall balance. You will get the volume. Now volume is varying through these relations, the area variations. So this actually gives the area. This actually also goes to this particular heat transfer equations. Now TS is typically supplied, or through this boiling point function relations, it is, so you can get this Q. So there is one particular flow in this direction we can see. Now, the CA and CB calculation also requires the value of this volume. So the component balance, the A and B component at the outlet, so that can be that can be available, that can be obtained from these particular relations. So these are like boundary input, as I was saying, F2. This is also a boundary input. This V, but it is getting calculated from here, so that is the input, act as an input. So intermediate unknown we can call. Then this CA and CB, which is basically the concentration of this A and B in the vessel, that are actually supplied, or that are actually passed to this block, which is a function of this CA, CB and rho. The density, so that you can calculate the specific heat of the vessel mixture. Now, how do you calculate the specific heat of a mixture of components?
Uh,
in general.
Enthalpy balance.
Enthalpy balance. So any other hints? Because I was trying to think what it could be the way of this algebraic relations. I yet to get a definite relations. That's why I have just made it in the form of functions. But there would be some mixture specific heat, right? So there would be some mixture specific heat that actually takes into account the component A and component B individual specific heat, which is the CA, CB, and also the density. Whether this concentration will come into picture or the volume or the mass, that we have to see. So if you can come up with the relations, algebraic relations, to calculate the specific heat of the vessel mixture. So try to get a relations. I am yet to get a definite relations. So I have to also think, but if you can do that, it would be good. So am I been able to tell you the problem? You have to calculate the specific heat of the vessel mixture, provided that you know the individual specific heat of A and B. You also know the density, and you have obtained in the intermediate step the concentrations of A and B in the vessel mixture. Remember, A and B are varying with time. The concentration of A and concentration of B are varying with time, but the individual specific heat and the density, they are remaining the same. So see how this C2, that is the specific heat of the vessel mixture, can be obtained from these variables. If you can get a through some balance, as you said, the enthalpy balance, if you can get a concrete relations, the algebraic relations, then it would be good. So try to see, and if you get, then we can discuss in the next class. And then this C2, which is basically the specific heat, then we have actually made this balance equation. Now let us see how the each term, the unit of each term, okay, so that you will get an idea. So F is the volumetric flow rate, right? And we have all the terms, let's say, multiplied by initially the rho, so that this term now is one. So multiplying all the term by rho, you will get the unit in terms of watt or joule per second, which is typically the rate of heat transfer, the unit. So this is the volumetric flow rate multiplied by the density, then the specific heat, then the temperature. Of course, there is a reference temperature term, TA minus T reference. So if you go like this, then you will be able to make a balance equations, and these are the inflow temperature of A and temperature of B, also the heat supplied from the steam jacket, and this is the one outlet, which is the T2, that is the same temperature as the vessel content, so that is at the outflow. So and this is the accumulation term, which is the volume multiplied by the vessel specific heat into rho and T2. So rho is basically the density of the vessel mixture. Sometimes what in this kind of problem where there are several liquid components that are mixed, we typically assume an average density of the complete system. That means the component density and the vessel mixture density are almost same. We don't see much variations. So this rho refers to the density of the whole vessel contents. So this is the enthalpy balance equations. So that gives you the T2. So as I said, this unknown variables here, initial values are given, V, CA, CB, and T2. You see that there are four integrating equations, CA, CB, V, and T2. So these four blocks should be available, should be made as a part of balance equations. This intermediate relations, which are actually area, specific heat, and heat transfer through this pressure temperature relations, this should be calculated intermediately. So maybe I just mark it a different color. So this four are part of intermediate relations, and this 1, 2, 3, and 4, these are unknown variables, which we are actually calculating through these differential equations. So this is the general strategy one would typically apply, or one would one should employ these steps in order to make a foolproof, you can say, foolproof IFT, information flow diagram. So is there, if any doubts, you can let me know now this about this particular problem. You can also see some complex example problem, or rather some of these examples from the Roger Ramirez book, which I'll share tomorrow after I finish this non-linear algebraic examples. Now this examples that is right now shown, it is a kind of application of DAE, which is differential algebraic equations. That means the set of equations, they contains both differential equations as well as algebraic equations. So solution of this kind of problem will be exhaustive, in the sense that it would have ordinary differential equations functions, as well as several nonlinear algebraic relations. So one or two examples will directly solve using MATLAB. And this kind of IFT that you have seen, we can have examples, or we can take examples from reactors, which is non-isothermal in nature. So some exothermic or endothermic reactions is happening, and there are some cooling jacket or heating jacket is there. So temperature variation as well as concentration variation as a part of reactions, we can directly solve. So for example, CSTR problem or plug flow reactor problem, where non-isothermal reactions are happening, and we want to see the temperature and product concentration variations or reactant concentration variations. So this particular type of problem we will directly solve through MATLAB by writing code and getting the results and analyzing the results. But this is just the IFT part we have solved. And so next we'll see those kind of directly applications in MATLAB. Yeah, I think that's all for today. Any questions?
Sir, can we leave now?
Yes, you have class now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sure. Thank you all. Tanmay, Kanak and Disha, you please stay back.
Sure, sir.